president, and for 11 years was a member of the board of the Cactus and Succulent Society of America, where he supervised publication and conventions of the organization. Aside from cactus, Leo has a home orchard with many kinds of citrus, apples, stone fruits, pomegranates, dates, guavas, bananas, and a mango tree. We've also experimented with breadfruit before, so he has a great resource for our Arizona chapter. I'd like to introduce Leo Martin.
Thank you. Okay, can you hear me in the back if I speak up like this, or should I use a microphone?
All right.
Everybody knows about the Ficus indica, the tuna, as it's called in Mexico. And it's the commonest cactus fruit eaten around the world. And people are familiar with dragon fruit now because there's been a lot of activity with dragon fruit, especially among the society. But there are a lot of cacti that are eaten by the people who are near where they grow. And a lot of them are delicious. And so I thought I would talk about some of those, because a lot of those, in many ways, are easier to cultivate than dragon fruit, for example, or Opuntia ficus indica. And also, we're not the first people that have grown and selected these fruits. This is Stenocereus trilisi, which is on the screen. That's only found in the Valley of Oaxaca. And it's thought that the Zapotec Indians who lived there selected that somehow. It's not known if it's a natural hybrid or if it's an intentional hybrid or whatever, but it only grows in that area. It has delicious fruits, and it's grown. You only find it along houses and other buildings. This was a restaurant where this one was growing. Here's my house. We're facing east. That's Camelback Mountain in the background. And when I bought the house, I didn't have time to take a picture because I don't have slides. I bought the house in 1986. And it looked like a parking lot, you know, standard, what people think of as desert landscaping, which is gravel with one rock and one cactus. I didn't like that, so I've improved it. This is my orchard. On the right, you can see the bird netting over my fig. Otherwise, I would not get any figs at all. There are a lot of citrus in there. The very large date palm is an unusual variety from China Ranch near Death Valley in California. And this is one of my cacti. And a lot of people say, well, I don't like cactus. They're spiny, they're ugly, they're dried up all the time. But I think they can look pretty good. In the background to the right is Opuntia robusta, which I'll be talking about a little bit later. Cacti are distinguished from all other plants by, first of all, they're flowering plants. They do have flowers. They're dicots, so when a cactus seed sprouts, it has two little seed succulent structures. They don't really look like leaves, except in the prickly pear group. And the thing that distinguishes them from other plant families are the areoles. Now, on this is a barrel cactus from Mexico. You see the felty patch from which the spines are coming? That is an areole. And that is pretty much what distinguishes a cactus. So if you look at something and it has an areole, then it's a cactus. The spines are modified leaves, and the areole itself is actually a modified branch. So if you can imagine a branch that's been constricted, that's what an areole is. When they're formed, they have two meristems. You know, a meristem is a bundle of growing tissue. One of those meristems forms the spines. The other meristem remains in reserve. And that can be used to make flowers or another stem, or possibly more spines, or possibly leaves, because some cacti do make leaves. A closely related family is the Didieriaceae, from mostly Madagascar. They're very closely related. They're also closely related to the Portulacas. And the Didierias do have areoles as well, but their areoles are not felty like this one. And this is one of those things in the Didieriaceae family. This is Alouatia montagnasi from Madagascar. You can see here the leaves are coming from just underneath the spines. And later on you'll see a photograph of the cactus with leaves, and you'll see the leaves on the cactus also coming from just underneath the spines. But the areoles on the Alouatias do not have felt. So if it has felty areoles, it's a cactus. This is a leafy cactus. There's a group of cacti. The genus is Pereschia. They are deciduous vines, trees, or shrubs. And they have leaves during their entire growing season. And I can prove it's known as a Barbados gooseberry because the fruit is eaten. And this is the stem of that plant. And you can see the areoles. You see leaf scars and spines. And there's a little bit of fuzz coming off of those. A lot of cacti have hairs around the areoles. So the left of the picture, you see some of the leaves still attached. This particular plant is a rampant woody vine habitat, and it doesn't tend to bear fruit until it's big, so there aren't many fruiting in the United States because it's extremely frost tender. But it's a widespread food plant through the Caribbean Basin out into Brazil, and they sell the fruits in the market. I've never tasted it. Another thing that distinguishes cacti is that the flowers don't have a real distinction between a sepal and a petal. So they're called perianth segments. Perianth means around the anthers. And so this is a cactus from Brazil. If you look on the outside, it's kind of hard to tell where the sepals stop and the petals start. Here's another one. This is also a Brazilian plant. You can see the open flower there on the right and the buds in the middle. And the petals and the sepals would be really hard to distinguish. And so we don't really talk about petals and sepals in cacti. There aren't many other plants like that. Thank you. This is a diagram from a book that I'll mention a little bit later. And it's a cross-section of a typical cactus flower. Cacti have what's called an inferior ovary. And that's important for the way we treat the fruit. It's something to remember. Inferior ovary means that the petals attach above the ovary. Remember, the ovary is where the seeds are. So the petals attach above. In a superior ovary plant, this petal attachment would be down here somewhere. And that would be something like an apple. And the difference is that with an inferior ovary, and almost all plants that have that, the ovary is sunk into a stem, a segment of the stem. And so a cactus fruit has areoles on the outside. Instead of most of the time being a beautiful, naked, shiny thing, it has spiny areoles. And a lot of them, they're modified that those fall off when the fruit is ripe. But typically, a cactus fruit has a rind, which is not that edible. That's not always the case, but typically. So the inside is the juicy part. And so that's another thing that lets you know it's a cactus, is that there are areoles on the fruit. Some of these cacti have fruits that can actually sprout. Because remember, an areole has an extra meristem. And so that areole can produce roots and sprout. And that's how some cacti reproduce themselves, in fact. Here's a real example. This is a cactus from Peru. So these are the floral parts up here. This is all a long tube. And the actual ovary will be way down in here. And so as this develops, this will swell up and get big and be filled with pulp. And this part turns brown and dries up. This is a plant from Brazil. It's a genus that is in Brazil all the way up into Mexico. We have a couple in the United States in the Keys. In this fruit, some cacti do have fruits that don't seem to have areoles, but their areoles are very small, so you can't see them. But here you can see the dead flower is attached here, so the ovary is below the flower. And that's what I mean by an inferior ovary. This is a sectioned fruit of the same species that we saw two flowers ago, the white one. This is an immature fruit. When it's mature, the seeds are black instead of brown. Here's the dead flower. You can see there are spines on the outside. You can see the rind. And then the juicy part is inside. What the inside of the cactus that you eat consists of, instead of jelly or something, they're little threads that connect the developing seed to what's called the placenta, which is where it attaches to the fruit. And that's something else in cacti have that's a little bit unusual, is that those threads that attach the seed to the fruit are swollen, juicy, and usually sweet. And that's something they develop to attract birds. In a lot of other plants, the rind would be thick and sweet, or there would be just undifferentiated tissue in there to be thick and sweet to attract the dispersers. But in cacti, what we're eating are actually the threads that attach the seed to the plant. As I mentioned, Tasinga is a plant that's in the prickly pear family. It has fruits that have areoles on them. And the main method that this kind of plant uses to spread is not the seeds. There are viable seeds in those fruits. But it will sprout a new stem from those areoles when they land on the ground. And it's an interesting thing to see. This fruit is about the size of maybe a quarter. And the parent plant under which it's fallen is about 8 feet tall. Cacti are native only to the New World. That's where they came from. There's one exception that's in Africa through Madagascar. That was thought to have been carried by birds thousands of years ago. But all the rest of the cacti are native only to the New World. They've been carried everywhere else. They live in climates everything from wet, year-round, hot jungle to the tundra. So they're cacti all the way from the Canadian tundra down through Tierra del Fuego. They occur natively in all the 48 continental states. They're not native to Hawaii. They're not native to Alaska. But the other 48 states all have existing native populations.
We found prickly pear in the Alps in Austria.
Yes. Yes, they've been carried all over the world.
Yep.
Now, cacti, almost all cacti, come from regions where they receive rain in the summer. There are only two species that live in an exclusively winter rainfall zone, and that's Southern California, San Diego County. But the rest of them get rain in the summer. That means you have to water them in the summer, especially if you live in California where you don't get summer rain. A lot of them are succulents not to survive the summer when it's dry, but to survive a long, dry winter. For example, in Mexico, it may rain for 2 or 3 months torrentially, then it's dry the rest of the year. I mean, 100% dry, no rain. And so these things are adapted to growing fast when they get plenty of rain and then being able to survive a long winter. So you have to water your cacti in the summer. This is how typically cacti look in Phoenix in the summer, because the homeowner thinks, well, it's a cactus, I don't have to water it. Now, most gardeners would look at this and your heart would go out to this poor plant struggling to stay alive. Fortunately, it's adapted that it will live. I mean, this plant's looked like this the whole time I've owned my house. It's across the street from me and I have to go get it every day. But if they just put one or two dripping bits there, this would be beautiful. Yes. And most of the cacti that whose fruits are eaten, Peru, Argentina, Brazil, Mexico, may get a half inch to an inch of rain a week during the summer. So if you want fruit production, you're probably going to have to water your plants. The soil is generally unimportant. There are no cacti that really are dependent on acid soil or alkaline soil, except some of the epiphytes do better with acid conditions, because that's what you would expect for an epiphyte. And of course, dragon fruit fall into that class. But for terrestrial cacti, the soil doesn't matter as long as it's well drained. I don't think there are any, well, there are a couple that are adapted to living in basically bog conditions in the summer. But that's only for a couple of months. There are a couple of mammal areas from Mexico that grow in really wet areas. But those are small cacti. The bigger cacti, they may have pretty wet soil during the summer, but it's generally well-drained. So you have to give them good drainage, especially if you have a lot of winter rain. So up on mounds or something like that. Most desert plants are adapted to a lot of light, but their seedlings are not. So if you get a small plant, don't expect you're going to be able to put that against a west wall in the summer. So it'll need some shade until it starts getting bigger. Because if you think about it, a bird eats fruit. The bird deposits the seed when it's done with it under a shrub where it's been sitting, and that's where the thing sprouts, and then it grows up through the shrub. In terms of fertilizer, people have been told not to fertilize the cacti. In the wild, they are associated with all sorts of microorganisms in the soil, just as are most other plants, and those plants provide them with quite a bit of nitrogen. And what's impressed me in the field is seeing these plants, and they look like these big, fat, puffed-up plants that the textbooks warn me against producing, but that's what they're supposed to look like. The issue with fertilizer is a lot of cactus books are written by people who live in places like Germany and London and other places near the Arctic Circle where there's no light. And if you give a lot of nitrogen fertilizer to a cactus and not enough light, it does look pretty bad. But if you have good light, like in California or here, you can fertilize them a lot and they'll just grow faster and look good. So anyway, cacti need water. Here's another example. This is also in my neighborhood. You know what this plant is, anybody? That's a ficus indica. Do they look like that? I mean, is that what you think it should look like? Look at how shrunken the pads are. So this house was bought by somebody about 7 or 8 years ago. This plant used to be on drip, and it hasn't been for the last 7 or 8 years. It's big enough. It's got this big trunk, so it can tolerate that. But it looks terrible all the time, and you don't see any fruit on it. Now, part of the reason you don't see fruit on it is that they don't actually do well here. It's too hot here in the summer, and it's too cold in the winter. So we get a lot of frost damage almost every winter. That's frost damage. It's very common here. Here's another example, more frost damage. This pad got so soft it broke off and folded over, and you can see all the scarring. That's frost damage. That's one reason why a lot of people don't grow this fruit here. It's common in the winter after a heavy frost over the next week. You drive around and under every ficus indica you see dead pads lying on the ground. Prodigious amounts of dead pads, and those have to be cleaned up all the time. And the other thing I've noticed, this is actually in my garden, as were the previous two. I planted these years ago hoping to get fruit and have a beautiful prickly pear fence the way I've seen in California, but that's not going to be here in Arizona. The other thing is that the quality of the fruit I produce isn't as good as some. So this is about the best fruit I can get. So ficus indica is not the best fruit here. But there are other Opuntias, that's the genus, that have good, delicious fruit that do well here. And something I'd like to convey to you is find Opuntias that do well in your climate, grow them for the fruit, and use them, because they'll probably taste better than Ficus indica. What we have here, actually what we have all the way from western Louisiana through Arizona and from Oklahoma south into Mexico is Opuntia engelmanni, which has very good fruits. This is a plant that's actually in a landscape along a road not far from where I live. And engelmanni, like I say, is native, takes the heat. It takes a lot of water in the winter because it lives in areas where it gets snow. Excuse me, snow. And look how many fruit are on this plant. This plant does get drip because the city of Paradise Valley maintains it. This is now, another thing. Look at the spines on this plant. See, there aren't that many. This is the same species. This has longer spines and more of them. Opuntia engelmanni, because of the huge range, has a lot of variability in terms of spine number, pad size, and such. But you can tell just it's a green, a medium green prickly pear with spines. That's engelmanni. This one doesn't get much supplemental water, so it doesn't have any fruit this year. This is yet another one. See, these spines are a little bit shorter than the previous ones you just saw. And we'll come back later and talk about this white fuzzy stuff on the plant. And this is another variety of engelmanni. This one's been called variety linguiformis, which means tongue-shaped. And this supposedly occurred natively in central Texas, yes?
How hard are you talking about when you say there?
This will take 0 Fahrenheit. Not every clone, but clones from the cold areas will. Linguiformis is originally from central Texas, we're told, although the native population is not known. And it's widespread in cultivation because it looks interesting. It's got this long, it's also known as the cow tongue or the Gene Simmons cactus. This one's also suffering for lack of water. But anyway, look at the number of fruits on this plant. So this plant does produce fruit. Now look at the number of fruits on this plant. I'd rather grow this one if I were growing for fruit production. You can see the cap. I realize that displaying this cap in this university is an act of war, because that's the University of Arizona cap. But nevertheless, it's the same size. So these are three plants. They're much more loaded with fruit. Notice over here, these top pads are a different color and they don't have any fruit. Those are this year's pads. Opuntias tend to produce fruit on last year's pads. And one take-home message on that is once they're a good size, prune them a lot, because you'll get more fresh pads each year, and then they'll make more fruit. This is an Opuntia engelmanni flower. Most of them are yellow. This is an unusual clone. It's this kind of orangey-red. Here's some developing fruits. And this is a plant. I took this picture, I think, in May. This is the same plant last week. Wow. This is pretty productive. This plant's less than 3 feet tall. That's a lot of fruit. The fruit's good size. And there's a close-up of it. Again, you can see the areoles. Here's the scar where the flower used to be attached. This is a section. And again, here's the stem. Here's the ovary, actually, the interior part with the pulp and the seeds. And it's I don't remember what diameter that plate is. I think it's about a 6-inch salad plate. There's obviously a U.S. quarter. And then here's the whole fruit. Now, I did it in that sequence rather than showing the whole one and the cut one, because I'm going to show you another species next so you can compare the size of a fruit to it. Remember I talked about Opuntia robusta in my garden? The next picture is an Opuntia robusta from that fruit from that plant. So the quarter is the same size as the quarter in the previous photo, and the plate is the same size as the plate in the previous photo. So this is a lot bigger fruit. And Opuntia engelmanni is very delicious tasting fruit. I think this one's even better. Only issue here is that it doesn't like the heat that much, so this doesn't fruit as well. In California, this fruit's a lot better. And in central and southern Mexico, this is the preferred tuna. And tuna is the name used in Spanish, in Mexican Spanish, for prickly pear fruit. And these come in anything from yellow to dark purple in Mexico. They grow up to be fairly large trees. But again, you need to prune prickly pears to keep producing new pads to get more fruit. This is a plant. This looks okay. I mean, it's not bad. But they look much bigger in California. Those pads, here's one of them, will get up to 2 feet in diameter in a good climate. it's pretty frost-hardy. It easily takes our frost. They're undamaged. My garden probably got down to the low teens last year, or this spring, and it was undamaged. And birds like this one more than they like the other ones around here. So bird protection is always important. And this is my plant. And that fruit that you saw sitting on the plate came from this aerial right here. That was the only one I got this year. As I mentioned, almost any of the red-fruited juicy prickly pears can be eaten. This is a Puntia aciculata, which is from southern Texas down into Mexico. And this is one that tolerates a huge amount of reflected heat, light, and sun, and all that. And so here it is growing in a friend of mine's garden. I wouldn't plant this one intentionally for fruit unless there weren't that many other options, because these are really nasty. Prickly pears and choyas are related. They have two different kinds of spines. They have the long, nasty ones. And they have these short ones, which are called glochids. These are big and obvious, but in a lot of them, they're so tiny you can't see them. They get into you, and they really hurt. They're flesh-colored, so they're hard to remove. But anyway, now, until recently, the way I prepared them for eating was I would take a bunch of fruit, put it in a blender, just cover it with water, puree it until it's a mess, pour it into a pot, boil it for a while to reduce it, and then strain it through cheesecloth to get rid of all the gunk and the spines, et cetera, et cetera. It works really well, but it's very time-consuming. A week ago, I gave a talk on growing cactus from seed to the Pinal County Master Gardeners, and I plugged this organization, and I plugged this conference, of course. And a lady started talking about how she processes several hundred pounds of prickly pear fruit from the wild a year here. And I said, well, that must take you forever. She said, no, I use a Jacqueline juicer. And I said, well, what happens to the glochids? She said, the juice comes out the sluice, and the remainder stays in the container. And I haven't tried it yet. I'm going to run out and get one, though, as soon as I have some time. Because that would be a lot easier than all this chopping up and boiling and straining it. And she said, all the junk you don't want gets compacted in a little ball that you can just dump out. And that would be a lot easier way to process these things. So I don't own any stock in Jack Lane or Costco where I got this picture or anything. Not every prickly pear has yummy fruit. A lot of them have dry fruits when they're mature. This is a prickly pear relative from Argentina. It's called tepper cactus. It's also known as a pine cone cactus. It's used in landscaping a fair amount. When these are mature, these fruits, they're dry and papery. There's no juice in there, so don't even bother. We have native ones in the United States also that have similar dry fruits, and so those aren't ones you'd want to grow for fruit. They do have beautiful flowers. And then there are other prickly pear relative fruits that I just have never tried because I don't feel like trying to harvest them.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
That, trust me, that doesn't work either. Remember the fuzzy white stuff? That's cochineal, which is a scale insect, not a mealybug, a scale. And it's a native insect. There are different species all the way from here all the way south. And it produces a dye when we squash the insect. That dye was an extremely important product of Mexico. There was more money in cochineal scale taken out of Mexico than gold. Cochineal is what built Oaxaca City and that gigantic monastery there, which has now been converted to a botanical garden, which is really beautiful, and you should go visit if you're over there. The English redcoats wore wool coats that were dyed with cochineal scale. And when you squish it, this is what's inside the body. Now, anybody know why I say ready for Snapple?
Snapple uses that.
Yes. If you pick up cosmetics, food, anything, and it says natural red food coloring, you're eating squashed insects. Yes?
Do you know what number it is?
Number what?
Usually it's red number...
No, those are for the artificial chemicals. Okay. This says natural red food coloring. Okay. Because they're afraid if they put squashed insect parts on your Snapple. This is the original bug juice. And if any of you ladies have red lipstick on, you have bug juice on your lips.
In the 90s, they actually used to label it as cochineal, and they switched.
Because people learn. Right. Okay. So, moving on. Myrtillocactus geometrizans is a cactus that's native pretty widespread in Mexico. It has some relatives that are not as frost-hardy as this, so they don't grow in the United States. Maybe they'll grow in California where you get less frost. But this is the only one we can grow here outdoors. It's a beautiful plant. And it has really tasty berries that are avidly collected. This is a photo from Ted Anderson's book. The berries are avidly collected and sold in markets. They're about an inch across. They taste like a kiwi fruit. These don't have areoles on the fruit, so you can eat the whole fruit. The rind is a little bit tough. This is a related species, Glimming. After the freeze last year, almost none of my fruiting cacti flowered this year. So I was kind of caught short. I expected to take all these pictures of fruit to show you, and I don't have them. But this is a relative, which grows very similarly, and the flowers are also very similar. You can see there's a hummingbird pollinating them. This tree, this is in Oaxaca. This was about 25 feet tall. This is just a small section of the plant. One unusual thing about the genus Cryptococcus, which is good for fruit production, they make more than one flower per areole. That's very unusual in the cactus family. And one areole may flower over many years. So with most plants, like the prickly pears, that areole flowers, that's it for that areole, won't flower again. With Cryptococcus, they will flower over and over and over again. And then they produce fruits, and they may flower more than once a year from the same areole. So this is a plant that produces quite a bit of fruit. Of course, the birds like it too.
Have you tasted that?
Yes, these are good. I have not tasted shank yet, but Cryptococcus geometrizans, which is the one we're really talking about. This photo is just to show you how it flowers. Because, again, mine didn't flower this year. And they don't flower this way in most people's gardens here because they don't water them enough. It'll have maybe 5 or 6 flowers a year. But if you water it enough during the growing season, give it some fertilizer, they will flower like this. This is back to the species we're talking about. It has few ribs, dark, black, awl-shaped spines, and kind of a gummy blue-green color that's really pretty. It takes full sun, takes partial shade also. It's variable. This plant has spines that are a little bit longer, and the next plant has spines that are still longer. They're all the same species. You need 2 of most cacti, 2 different clones to set fruit. So later on I'll show you one that's self-fertile, but it's like the dragon fruit. Most of the time you need 2 separate plants to set fruit. That doesn't mean cuttings from the same plant. It's 2 different genetic plants. And there is also a lot of variability in stem shape. This is a wider one, this is a narrow one. These 2 always stay the same diameter when they get big. The next plant is one that I kind of discovered was edible that I didn't know about, the fruit. Acanthocereus tetragonus is a tree in Oaxaca. The plants here, it's not a big tree. It's a trunk maybe up to 6 feet tall and it sprawls. The plants here are almost all tip cuttings. So like with evergreens, if you take a tip cutting, you wind up with a ground cover. This plant doesn't form a trunk. I've tried to train it, but I've just given up, and I let it crawl in the trees. And it grows like one of the Selenocereus or the Hyloceraeus, kind of like a big sprawling vine, but it has no aerial roots. So it needs something to lean against or crawl into. It blooms on and off throughout warm weather, and the flowers open at night. They close the next morning when it gets hot. This was taken about 5 o'clock in the morning. And this plant will tolerate full Arizona sun and heat. Well watered. Your dragon fruit, even in California, need a lot of shade. This plant will not. The fruit is not as big as a dragon fruit. In fact, it's a lot smaller. A mature fruit is about the size of a golf ball. It's red, spiny on the outside, but when it's ripe, it lets you know by splitting in half and exposing this little ball of pink flesh inside. And it has a really nice flavor with a good balance of acidity and sweetness. And every flower will produce fruit because the bees do the job for you, and the moths at night. And this plant is self-fertile, you don't need 2. Now, if you look in the picture, here's a fruit developing with a floral remnant attached, and there's one up here. So that's the best I can do in terms of showing you the fruit, because I expect to take a lot of pictures, and I was hoping even to freeze some and bring them here, but this plant didn't flower this year after a big freeze last year. Here's a side view of the buds. This is where the fruit develops, and this is the tube of the flower. So again, areoles on the sides of cactus fruits. And then here's yet another photo of that same bud open. Now this is what happened to my big plant this year. It's a big Calverde on my property. And this plant used to be loaded with flowers, but February of this year, it just got damaged by that. We had not just low temperatures, because in January of 2007, it was colder at my house, and this plant was undamaged. So January of 07, it got down to 18 in the garden section. It was colder here. This year, it was maybe about the same, maybe a little bit warmer. But we had a night when it was well under 30, well like down into the mid-20s, and 30 mile an hour wind. And that was what did it in a lot of things. So even though I had a lot of things covered with light bulbs, it doesn't matter because the cover blows up and the wind blows all the hot air out. So this plant's, the botanist that led the trip I was on here said he had never seen a fruit in the wild because people that live in the area wake up at the crack of dawn to go get them. And he said it's one of the best tasting fruits. They're readily available in the markets during season because people go out there. It's like the Italians hunting mushrooms in Northern California. You can't ever find the ones you're looking for because some old Italian guy with a bucket got there, you know, 2 in the morning. But anyway, Cepocereus bradyi, this plant is about 3 feet tall. It's a bluish plant, and the fruit is about 2.5 inches in diameter. It's a globe, and it's bright blue, like really bright blue. And it has a watery pulp instead of the solid pulp, very watery, and it's said to be delicious. I didn't eat them because we weren't there in season. This is the habitat it grows in. It's limestone rock, but it grows on anything. The black is from the microorganisms growing, blue green algae, the cyanobacteria. And here's some plants, they're about 3-4 feet tall. There's a white spot here, that's a person sitting down. And this area, I ask, whenever I went on these trips, whenever I go on these trips, I ask what the temperatures are like, so I have some concept of what they'll take. This area in the summer is about 120 degrees in the shade. These plants are growing on bare rock. But they do get rained on every day. So that's a key to a lot of Brazilian plants, because a lot of Brazilian plants have good fruit. Sun and heat, yes, and this plant will also grow in less sun and less heat, but they need plenty of water to go through that. They're variable like everything else. Here's a plant with spines, which most of them don't have many spines at all. And interestingly, the juveniles have a different spine formation. That's very common in the cactus family. Juveniles will have more spines or longer spines, and as they mature and need less protection from animals, the spines modify. We see that in saguaros, we see that on the big cactus in Baja California, the cardone. They're really spiny when they're small, but when they get big, the spines almost go away. And this is mine in my garden. They are available. The Huntington Gardens in San Marino sells them. And a cactus nursery called Grigsby in San, actually in Vista, sells them. And I'm thinking that this, although I don't know what the frost hardiness is, because we've been too afraid to test them because it's only been available for about 5 or 6 years. It is from a relatively high elevation area, so I don't know. I don't know what I can tell you. I've had them survive under my carport during the freezes, so they'll tolerate it down to freezing levels. And I think it'd be worth a try because the fruits are supposed to be so good. These are the buds. This is real color. My camera did not have trouble reproducing this. That's the actual color of the buds, and the fruit's the same color. Because remember, here's the flower tube, and then this is the ovary down here. And that's the bud. They bloom at night. So even though we were there about 6 in the morning, they were already shutting up. There's a lot of information in this book. Ted Anderson was a research botanist at the Desert Botanical Garden here in Phoenix, just a few miles away from here. And this was his magnum opus. It's a scientific review of the cactus family where he covers all the genera and all the species. Some of the names have been changed since then, but not that many. This is a very good reference point, and it's in your handout as well. And he was trained as an ethnobotanist, as an anthropologist. So there's a very long chapter at the beginning on the ethnobotany of cacti, including the uses for food, fuel, and other uses. And he was also an expert on peyote, Lophophora williamsi, which is a cactus from southern Texas and New Mexico. And he wrote a number of books on the anthropologic books on how the native peoples of that area use them. Unfortunately, he passed away just a few days after this book was published, but it remains a very good book. And this is another excellent book. Wendy Hodgson is a botanist now at the Desert Botanical Garden. This is Food Plants of the Sonoran Desert. She published this back in 2001. And on the cover, those are saguaro fruits of the saguaro cactus. It's a very important food for Indians here because they ripen during a season when there's nothing else to eat. And that's how a lot of plants evolve, is they present something to be dispersed by the animals, or they present a flower to the pollinators at a time when nothing else is available. So the pollinators are forced to go to that flower, or the birds are forced to go there and distribute the seeds. So the saguaro ripens May, June, sometime in that range, which is our driest and hottest time of the year, and any of the winter annuals are already dead, so there's not much available for fresh food. Just as earlier in the hot season, the choya buds, the prickly pear relatives that grow with cylindric stems, those are ready in the middle of that hot season, and that's the only vegetable available at that time of year, and the Indians ate those too. But to give you an idea, I don't know how well you can read this, to give you an idea of how important cacti were to the people in this region, in the Sonoran Desert, it's organized by family, and you can see how many pages are devoted to each of these things. Now, you say, wow, that's a lot of pages for agaves, because Wendy thinks that the agave was the main calorie source for the Indians of the Southwest, because they cultivated the agaves, and they were available all year. Corn, beans, and squash depended on summer rain, and if you didn't have summer rain, you got no corn, beans, and squash. But the agaves would still flower during a drought year. Just before they flower is when they're full of starch, and that's when they're eaten. So you can see how important the agaves were compared to other things. The beans are on the next page, so, and I didn't photograph that, but the beans get 27 pages. And look here at cacti. Cactaceae. 47 pages. That's the biggest section of this book, Food Plants in the Sonoran Desert, is devoted to cacti. And the fruits were collected and eaten. The seeds were ground into paste and eaten of different species. The flower buds were eaten in the spring when there's nothing else in terms of the vegetable. The wood left over after they were dead was used for building. And before we talk about sources, on the back of the handout, I talk about a few other plants I didn't have time to show. But the genus Stenocereus, there's one species in the U.S. that's the organ pipe, Stenocereus thurberi. I believe we ate some of the fruits out there because it's known as Pitayo dulce. And Edgar brought some fruits of those. They're really sweet. Dulce means sweet in Spanish. But the whole genus is full of columnar plants that branch from the base that produce fairly large fruits. And as I mentioned, remember my title photo was Stenocereus trilisi, and that was selected out by the Zapotec in Mexico for the quality of the fruit. There are a whole bunch of others that have good fruit. Stenocereus gamosus is native to Baja California and extends into the winter rainfall region. So that's one that would certainly be worth trying in California because it's called pitaya agria, which means sour pitaya, but it's not sour at all. The people I know that have eaten a lot of different Stenocereus say it's one of the best. It's a little bit too cold here for it to live. Every cold year, like every 5 years, my plants have been killed. So I'm not putting that out in the garden anymore. And it's a large plant before it fruits. But in California, I think it'd be worth a try. But there's a whole list there of ones that are considered to be good eating. Then I mentioned the Parestias. Parestia culiata is that 1 gallon plant I showed with the leaves. Another species that's eaten is Parestia guamacho, which is a tree from coastal Venezuela. The Huntington also distributed those a few years back. They may still have some. The problem with the Parestias is that they're very tender to frost, so we have to be protected.
I got Parestia 3 years ago down in South Florida, but it had a bright red-colored fruit, like a cherry tomato, and it had green leaves coming out of the fruit.
That was that could have been the Barbados gooseberry.
Yeah.
Because it's variable.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And my plant, 3 years old, from seed, it's had flowered for 2 years. Never had a fruit yet, but loads of flowers, and it hasn't been frost sensitive at all. It's made for 32 with no soil.
Oh, well, when I say frost, I think about outside here.
Yeah, maybe it's outside.
But we can get to the 20s here easily.
Yeah. Maybe that's freeze. That's not frost.
Okay. And also, Parestias definitely need two. You need two individuals. They're not self-fertile.
Okay.
Okay, and then, so... So there, what time is it? How many questions can we take? 20 minutes.
I got here a little bit late, but I didn't hear anything about Cereus trobionus. And another question associated with is that some of your pictures of Myrtilla cactus look almost identical to what I would call Cereus trobionus.
Okay. Well, I didn't talk about Cereus peruvianus because I've never had one that I thought was worth eating. They produce a lot of fruit, I mean, on and off. The birds usually get it, they're hard to protect. But there are some that are supposed to be good eating. I've talked to people who said, I had a really good one. I never had.
Yeah, well, there are some people in our club that think it's the best fruit there is. So.
Okay. But let me finish with the rest of your question. So it's also a very large plant, and in terms of size of plants or amount of fruit production, it's not great. It's not a well-maintained plant. It doesn't take that many fruits compared to the size.
But it doesn't take much area.
It doesn't take all that much area, but it takes an area 10 feet in diameter easily. Now, of course, you can keep them pruned. The pictures I showed of the Myrtillocactus, the differences between the Myrtillocactus and Cereus peruvianus, Cereus have very different flowers than Myrtillocactus. These Myrtillocactus flowers are about an inch across or less. Cereus flowers are bigger. Cereus have much sharper edges to the ribs. Myrtillocactus have these rounded, and it makes you almost want to go up and touch it. And Cereus tend to have different kinds of spines. They're white. They're not black like this, and they have a different kind of arrangement on the areole. And there are a lot of Cereus that are almost spineless. The branching habit is different. When grown from seed, a Myrtillocactus has a short trunk, maybe this tall, and then it branches out, whereas Cereus always branches. Well, that's not true. There are a couple species that grow way up, but what's called Cereus peruvianus here branches from the base. Whereas the Myrtillos, if you grow from seed, or even small cuttings, they'll branch farther up the trunk. They don't get as big. Cereus is a much bigger plant than Myrtillocactus geometric sense. So, this lady had a question.
Somebody has been advertising something called Nepovita on television a lot. It's supposed to be a miracle anti-inflammatory thing. And are they the same as anything you show us?
Well, Nopal is... she said that there's something called Nopalita being advertised.
I think so.
Something called Nopalita being advertised as a miracle cure-all. Nopal is the Mexican term for the vegetable prepared from prickly pear and pats. If you haven't all tried it, you should. It's pretty tasty. It tastes a lot like green beans. They can be sliced thinly and put raw in salads, or it can be cooked and added to things. It's kind of mucilaginous like an okra. You can buy them at the store with the aerials already carved out. My ladies must have really thick palms. The Nepal has a lot of properties in it that are medicinal. It lowers blood sugar. It's used for that, and as do some of the fruits. It's used for that by the Indians in this area, the Tohono O'odham. And eating it regularly does seem to lower blood sugar. The mucilage has been used for, like mucilage for aloe, treating wounds and burns and such. Gentleman in the back.
On that same point, have you noticed any kind of taste differences between the different kinds of pads?
I haven't tried that many different species. I don't prepare myself. I don't have the patience to do this. So I buy them in the store. Sir?
Yes. I heard that around the turn of the century in Northern California that they bred a whole bunch of varieties of edible cactus with no spines and a true fruit by Luther Burbank.
Right.
What happened to all of those different varieties of cactus that he bred and developed?
They were almost all lost. Do you know more about that, Raul?
Yeah, that was a big...
Let me introduce Raul. Raul is a research botanist at the Desert Botanical Garden.
Yeah, he was involved in breeding some of the prickly pears, but there was a big controversy between Burbank and David Griffith, who was an agronomist at the USDA. 10, 15 years previous to Burbank's breeding program, David Griffith went collecting in Mexico. He collected and described himself more than 30 species of prickly pears. He brought into the States a lot of these spineless forms. So one of what Griffith was saying is that Burbank's prickly pears have been actually selected by the Aztecs a couple hundred years or 500 years earlier than that. So that was a major hit. He did work with some of the prickly pears, but apparently what happened was he had a lot of nurseries selling his prickly pears, and they were advertising and exaggerating what he had actually done.
Are they still available anywhere?
Most are not.
Yeah, I guess. You might be able to find some of the places.
If you go to a market, that sells prickly pears, you just take those caps home and root them. If you find some.
But it is basically a phytosyndica in several. Basically, phytosyndica, they have found more than 300 varieties of types of phytosyndica.
Ficus indica is not known from the wild also. It's always cultivated, so we don't know where. There are a lot of plants like that that the Aztecs brought into cultivation, and there are no known native populations. So the Ficus indica, a lot of the agaves are only known from cultivation because they were selected forms, selected for fiber or fuel or something, or food. And like the tuberose, the common flower, it smells really good. That's Mexican, but it's not known in the wild. We don't know where it came from.
Are there any known poisonous cactus fruits?
I have wondered about that myself. I don't know about peyote fruit. For one thing, it's so small, I've been told, that probably people wouldn't want to eat them. But I honestly don't know. There are a couple poison cactus, peyote being one of them. The San Pedro cactus, which is it's a relative of this, with white flowers, it's a tall columnar from Peru, has the same compounds in it that peyote does. And that's why you can't grow it in the front yard in California, because they disappear right away. So hippies know what it is. But, so there are cacti. I don't know about fruits that are poisonous. I just don't know. By the way, on the topic of the spineless prickly pears, they don't have the big long spines. They still have glochids, the little tiny nasty ones. You still have to carve out the areas. Question here.
Yeah, well, did you mention, like, you know, the flowers of these?
Yes, a lot of cactus flowers can be eaten, too. And they work. Anything else? Yes.
I've been eating nopales for a long time, and I never carve out the aerials.
Okay.
So what I do is take a paper towel and wad it up and rub it, and it knocks off all the big spines. And the rest of them don't seem to bother at all.
Yeah, you can peel them. You can also just hold them over a fire, and the fire will burn off most of the glochids. One of the best ways I've ever had it prepared was, and this was in Mexico, they took a pad, and you use a young pad, you don't use a tough and mature pad, it's all scarred, but a young pad, split it in the middle like a bit of bread, stuffed it with white cheese, and then grilled it. That was really good. Any other questions?
Well, just a comment. There is actually a type of cactus in the San Joaquin Valley called the Bakersfield Beavertail, which only receives water during the winter time.
Okay.
And it's native to Mediterranean climates. It's an endangered subspecies. And then on the Papuntia robusta, I have one at my house that I think was there from before, but it has roots that are about like this big.
Yes.
I mean, it's really big. They taste kind of like beets. Like, they're not very sweet.
Well, they don't do so well here, and I bet you're not fertilizing them.
Oh, yeah, it's not fertilizing. It's not on a sure hill.
Remember, plants in the wild get a lot of nitrogen from those commensal microorganisms.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There are handouts on the back table. So I need 50. I don't think there are 50 people in here. Anything else? All right, well, thank you so very much.